Hello, everyone. You're listening to Truth Cat Radio. The current time is 8 o'clock p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's East Coast, USA. I am broadcasting on truthcatradio.com from Chicago, Illinois, myself, actually. My name is Richard Kary, and this is Beyond the Matrix. Haitham Khatib will be discussing various current events and just a lot of general information from his home in Palestine today. We're very excited to have him on live from Palestine. And before we get to Haitham, I do just want to mention to all of you that we are listener supported. We are not accepting corporate advertising. We're not monetizing. The archives are all free. So if you can, please support our station. We have a support page on our station website, URL www.truthcatradio.com. PayPal is accepted, and any little bit will help. In the world of independent media, no donation is too small. So please do what you can to help keep things going here. Please join our TruthCat Facebook group, our TruthCat group, our pages for TruthCat Radio, TruthCat, Beyond the Matrix. We appreciate the likes. You know, it always helps the numbers to get the word out there to everyone. If anyone would like to call in to speak to Haitham tonight, the number 714-598-3125. The call in number again, 714-598-3125. Please be sure to turn off your radio when you call in. Don't say anything when in the call-in queue. I will verbally invite you to speak by your area code. Once again, if you can, please help out and support the station with whatever you can. Now then, Haitham, hello. Are you with us?
Yes, I am with you.
Hi. Well, thank you again, first of all, for being with us at this hour. I know you're close to Jerusalem, where you are, and it's about 3 a.m. Correct?
Yes, exactly. Thank you for giving me this chance to speak about Palestine in the radio show. Thank you so much.
Certainly. The pleasure is mine. You know, it's an honor to have you on, sir. And it's been good getting to know you as well. In the time we first made contact up until now, I've enjoyed our conversations very much. You're becoming a friend, definitely. I appreciate your time.
Yeah, you would come.
Well, I normally like to try to introduce the guests a little bit. Haitham is a self-taught freelance Palestinian photographer, videographer, and documentary filmmaker. He provides and maintains much of his work online and describes himself as a peaceful activist. I know originally, Haitham, you said you were a farmer. I know your father was a farmer as well.
Yes.
Okay, but yeah, you no longer have the land that you had, or are you still farming?
Yes, I still farming. I have little land. My land now is close with the wall, the apartheid wall, what Israel make in 2004, and in 2005 they start to build in my village. My village is very small village. It's about 2,000 people, Israel start in 2005 cutting trees and stealing lands to build their settlement there. And it's begun. It's my village was no one know. No one know also in Palestine about my village, or no one see my village in the map before. But now my village has become it's like symbol of non-violent resistance in Palestine. It's begun in 2005. When Israel start to stole land for to build a settlement, and they was saying that they was they going to build security wall, but it's not true. It's just was they was stealing land and build settlement. In the same moment, I hear the people is speaking about that, and it was little far from where I live in the village. And I go with people, I see by my eyes a bulldozer cutting trees and destroyed the area there. And it's really strong pain was inside of me, because all my childhood I spent under the trees, and I spent my all my life in this area running and playing when I was child, and nothing I can do. Just we try to stop the bulldozer, but nothing help. And after a few days, we make meeting, and we make popular committee in the village. My village is making popular committee to know how to stop these bulldozers. And at the same time, I was thinking in another way, that to take photos for this bulldozers how cutting our trees and lands. And it was my start there. I start to be a photographer and document everything in my village. I see all the time the soldiers. It's not like if they see cameras in the place, and always they will stop me and try to cover me from what happened there. I see it's my way. What I doing is very peacefully way, and it's not danger to do this. But in the same time, it was really danger to do what I doing in the beginning. And in 2005, the soldiers shoot me in my head by rubber bullet, and it was really, really terrible. And I spent 5 days, 3 days in coma in hospital, and it was really, I don't know, it's really hard was for me to continue, but in the same time, it's give me something like to make, it's given me to make me strong what happened to me, because I see that I doing something and the soldiers is not like. And I see that the camera is making the violent lists, and in the same time, soldiers is always using the violent against people, and against who's participate against them to stop their bulldozers, or to stop them from stealing lands. And there I start serious. And some organizations is contact me, like Beit Salem, human rights organization, because at the same time they broke the camera. And B'Tselem started to give me support, like any camera, soldiers going to broke, they give me another camera. And I start, and soldiers always was try to stop me. They invade my home 5 times, searching my home. They shoot me a few times. They arrest me 1 week, but I continue. I continue because I see that I can do something for my village. It's two important things was for us in our demonstration against the Israel apartheid wall and settlement, the media and the activist, international activist, and Israeli as an Israeli activist in the same time. It's so danger if the Palestinians alone making these demonstrations, because the occupation soldiers will use the live bullets against us, and it's easy also to kill anyone. But in the same time, we have our friends, international activist friends, in our demonstrations, and an Israeli activist. It's stop the soldiers to do this, because it's happened a few times, shoot American guys or European guys or an Israeli guys, and they have a lot of problem in the courts in their countries. The camera is very important to show the truth and to be like a witness in the same time what the soldiers using the violence against us. My camera has helped a few activists to release from jail because always soldiers is lying again about the activist who was participate in our demonstrations. Sometimes they say he's tried to push soldier, or he's tried to do something against the soldiers. But when the court see the videos and the photos, they see that the soldiers is lying. I am proud that I help a lot of people for that, and at the same time also my camera has helped a few children was kidnapped from their homes during night, and it's I have a lot of problem when I faces the soldiers in the night. When they invade my village during night, but one thing is make me strong in the same time. It's when I remember that Israeli soldiers arrested me in 2000 in 92. I was 15 years old, and I spent 2 years in jail. I remember these days and how scary this time was.
I can imagine. Yes.
Yes, and in the same time when they start to arrest the children or who's participating in demonstrations against them, I was thinking in the same moment. They was arrest me. It's and I choose to be next to these children, and trying to tell them, "Don't worry, I am here." Because in the same time they was arrest me, no one was next to me or give me little hope or little to be strong. Soldiers when the soldiers invade the village, it was try to stop the demonstrations. They was shooting gas in the middle of the night, and they still also till the still till the till now invade the village and shooting the gas in the middle of the night or in the early morning to the homes. In the same time, children, women, sick people sleeping, and I filming few times when the soldiers was throwing the sound bombs on the homes. I filming when the soldiers broke doors and kidnap people. All this they was doing, they trying to stop our demonstrations. It's our demonstrations is very peaceful demonstrations.
And just to clarify again for the audience, you spent 2 years in prison from a 15 years old to 17 years old simply for you and some other children throwing some stones, even though no one was harmed.
Yes. They charged me that I was throwing stones. But you know the story, the real story, why I throw one or two stones at the same time. I was studying the village called Kufurnama, next to my village, because my village have a small school before, and the high school was in another village. Always we was on the break, we was going on the street and buying ice cream from a guy. He was sell ice cream every day, and we know this guy, and he was really friendly and very nice guy. And one day the soldiers invade the village, and it happened some clashes. But they was shooting everywhere. They killed this guy, and all the school was so angry, and all the school is going and throwing stones to the soldiers. It's why they arrest me. It's because I was angry because they killed my friend. He was sell us ice cream. It was the reason, and it's really stupid reason, but
no, I can understand it. You're still children, and yeah, no, that was emotional. But 2 years in prison for that is just
2 years,
amazing.
Yes, 2 years in prison. Now, if someone throws stone, he's going 3 months or 6 months. But before, in the first intifada, they tried to broke all the people in Palestine to not make their voice aloud. They try to stop everything, also to not hold flag. You know, if you holding a flag, you go to jail. If you do anything against the occupation, also if you speaking in loudspeaker, if you writing something on the walls, you go to jail. Everything, it's they try to stop the first intifada, but they cannot. The first intifada is continued 10 years, and then after is coming the second intifada. These people, they want to live in peace. These people, they want to end the occupation. It's our this our goal, to end the occupation. In my village, if I focus my village, it's very small area, very small village.
How do you pronounce it again? How do you pronounce it, the name?
Bil’in.
Okay.
My village is called Bil’in. I think you hear about five broken cameras film. It's almost he's take the Oscar. And he's take already the Emmy from United States. This film was really succeed, and speaking about what happened in my village, just in my village. It's very small village, and imagine if I am speaking all this about a small village and see how much we have village and cities in Palestine and what happened. If you, I think you will not visit Palestine before, but if you visit Palestine, you will see. Or if you visit Palestine for a few or two, for example, if you visit Palestine 2 months, 3 months, you can feel what happened there. But for a few days, I think you not have good time or enough time to know what happened there. Just to stay and to see exactly what the occupation did or still doing against us.
Well, I know the harsh conditions.
The harassment.
Yes.
It's every day we have harassment from occupation. See, in 2003, it's Oslo negotiation, peace negotiation, it's start. Until now, it's about 25 years now. We had nothing. We just waiting for their promises. I see its occupation is fighting to save the occupation, and I see my people is fighting to have freedom. All this time, it's more than 70 years now, or almost 70 years, and we are under occupation. We not have any human we not live like any human in this world.
You're losing more and more of your land, so that affects how much food to grow or import food.
We're not speaking just about land or food. Or occupation is occupied everything. It's occupied also the air, what we breathing. Mm-hmm. I'm sure if he can stop the rain, he will do. He's occupied the water. He's control the water, control the electricity, control the people where to go.
Well, you mentioned the electric to me a little bit, even early on when we were connecting on the internet, and just the kind of restrictions on internet speeds, electricity. You have power generators to be able to sustain other hours of the day. Isn't that correct?
You speak about Gaza. Gaza, it's about more than... I think it's more than 14 hours they not have electricity, and they using the motors to have electricity, and not for all. It's Gaza. You speak about Gaza. It's Gaza under the siege long years, and they keep them in a small jail and or big jail. It's a very small area. But Gaza, it's if I try to explain where Gaza and where West Bank, you not believe it's all in Palestine, but Israel in the middle, and Gaza now next Africa, and West Bank in Asia, and I never go to Gaza. I never in my life I try a few times to go to Gaza because Gaza have the sea, and or to go to Israel or to go to Gaza.
Well, I know a lot of land is being taken in the West Bank. I know they just approved 464 new settlement homes in the West Bank that they keep.
And all this area, it's Palestine history. It's from 48. They start to occupy Palestine till now, and Palestinians in peace negotiation they accept to speak about 67 border when the Israeli occupied in the 67 again West Bank and occupied Jerusalem, and now I am from Ramallah area.
And you're right near Jerusalem. You're close to correct.
Yes, and yes. Jerusalem is very close to Ramallah, and I cannot go to Jerusalem. They not allowed me to go to Jerusalem or to give me permission to visit Jerusalem. This one thing, and many places I cannot visit. For example, Jaffa, they called Jaffa in English. Jaffa. It's my grandfather's city. I maybe I visit Jaffa one or two times when I was a child in school. I traveling with the school. It's so hard to hear about that my grandfather, he was living Jaffa, and he's go to West Bank, and the occupation again is follow to West Bank and occupied West Bank. It's so hard to see your grandfather always put the transistor radio in his ear. He was old, and he's always hear the news. He have a hope to return to his land or to his city,
Yes.
and he's die and he's not achieved this dream. And my father, he's die and he not achieved any dream. And I am 40 years old now, and I see that occupation is still occupation and not give us any right to live in peace here. It's what I can speak about occupation. Occupation is occupation. It's apartheid. It's a kind of an inhuman thing. It's like
I know
no
that,
human.
right?
Occupation is no human.
You get treated like you're a prisoner or criminal constantly. I know the amount of rations of everything
Yes.
can be affected, and just the treatment in general. You say though that there's more harsh conditions with, well, I know of certainly with the killings in Gaza, just the casualties, the human casualties are far larger. But in the areas near you, though, I mean, have there been, any casualties on average, or any sort of hostile situations, or has it been not as extreme in your region?
Yeah, it's about Gaza. I hear about Gaza like you exactly. If you check internet and see what happened in Gaza, it's exactly. I am like you in internet. I can see Gaza, and I prefer if you want to speak about Gaza, I prefer someone from Gaza. He have to speak about Gaza, not me. I can travel here in West Bank free. I can go everywhere. I can, and I can document and filming anything happened here. It's we can do it in West Bank, but in Gaza it's different. I am not have the feeling of these people or the same feeling. They
So
have
there
three.
wouldn't. There wouldn't even be able to be people like yourself there then. Even that sort of independent media that wouldn't be allowed, even to the amount that you have a website and a Facebook. Is that part of what you're saying?
It's maybe I'm not understand what you're asking, what
Well, the conditions with the occupation are so harsh there. There wouldn't even be a journalist able to do what you do. Over in Gaza. Is that what you're saying?
See, it's many journalists killed during Gaza war or during West Bank demonstrations against occupation. Also international journalists also they lost their lives in Gaza and West Bank. Maybe you hear about Richard Kary. Richard Kary, she's tried to stop bulldozer was bulldozer was want to demolition home in Gaza, and they run over at her and she's died.
Hey guys,
Maybe
sorry.
you're
Sorry for interrupting you.
oh.
Rachel Corey, Richard. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
Rachel Corey.
Rich.
You know about Rachel Corey, Richard?
Yes, I know about her and
I know
every
you do.
Palestinian.
I'm just,
No.
I'm asking Richard. Richard, you know about Rachel Corey, right? Well, no, actually, if
Girl,
you could.
American girl. I'm so sorry.
I'm sorry for interrupting you. I'm so sorry
because you not know about her, because she's American activist and she's tried to be next to us. At the same time, Israel was demolishing homes in Gaza.
Yeah,
and,
I see. Okay.
And also Italian journalist and was killed in 2014. I speak with his mother in Facebook and. And it's really, I feel that I am who's killed there, because it's the same thing. It's anyone. They may not make different between journalists or anyone. The shooting from their planes, from sky. The shooting from sky. They didn't care. They killed many civilians.
Well,
2,200 people they killed in 2014.
Yes, you have a lot of footage that depicts that. I know on your images from Palestine.
Yes, it's my page, and I some admins there, not just me, who's published. And I have friends publishing, helping to publish news in the page. My personal page is Haitham Khatib Facebook.
Right, I've seen that as well, yes.
Yeah. Sometimes I was publishing about Gaza, but before I post anything, I was asking my friends, the journalist friends in Gaza. I cannot post anything I am not sure about. It's so dangerous. We have to be sure before we post anything in the internet.
And even then, it could get attacked. Correct? I mean, I would think at least. You have to see how each situation goes when you post.
It's yes. We have to be sure before we post anything. Because we have a lot of friends now around the world. They're waiting to see the news from Palestine. And we have to be so clear about what we're publishing. And, you know, you have to tell the truth. I am not media. I am not any media like your country or other country. I am not big media, or my friend is not big media. But
well, that's good. I mean, big media in our country only lies to us. So I mean, we're glad you're not big
media. This is what I going to say, because I give some footage for some big televisions. And it's like I give them, for example, half an hour video. They publishing 1 second and they're not speaking anything like what I tell them. It's this media just if you give this media the news from big tube, they give the people from very small tube. It's like they try to cover everything. They just publishing very small thing about Palestine. It's propaganda, and look who's control this media, and it's so dangerous. But see, we have internet now. We have Facebook, we have websites, we have many, many things from internet. You can post in Palestine, and you can go and follow the Palestine news or any news around the world. And so fast, and you can see all the truth there. And they're not editing the videos like what the big televisions editing. It's most of the what they're showing is propaganda all the time, and they lies to their people. But what you see from your friends, If you have journalist friends in Palestine, you can see the truth without anything, without.
That's why.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's why I thought you would be an excellent person to have speak to our listeners. Just the amount that a photographer experiences, you know, in these places and witnesses firsthand, there's no lying about that. You know?
Yeah, I can tell you a very small example. It's happened in my village. It was a friend of mine. His name's Basim Abu Rahman. This guy, he was friendly. He was really friendly with everyone coming to my village, with international, with the Israeli activists, with everyone. Who's go to Bil’in? The first guy he met, Basim Abu Rahman. And during the one demonstration in 17 April in 2009, Basim Abu Rahman was hold a poster and speaking with soldiers, asking them to stop shooting, and they shooting him in his chest and they kill him. And one journalist, he was meet Basim in the same day, and he's welcome him and he's take him to the demonstrations, and he see this by his eyes, and he's take photos for the moment when they kill Basim. Okay, after 3 days of his funeral. This photographer, he from Switzerland. He come to the village and he say, I want to speak with the friends of Basim, and I was one of this friends. He start to speak about his plan to go to Israel. He didn't know anything about Palestine. He said, I'm coming to Israel to take photos for the old cities, Yafa, Akka, Haifa. And he's not have any idea that this cities was occupied in 48 by Israel's occupation. And he said, after I finish taking photos, I say to myself, why to not take some photos for Bedouin and their camels? This what was what he hear about Palestinian or Arab or Palestinians, and he asking he want to go to meet these people and to take photos for them. And because Bil’in was it's little everyone know Bil’in from the international. Who's coming to visit? He meet someone in Ramallah and he take him to Bil’in. This he what he say and how he's telling the story. And he say, I see it's not what I was here before about Palestine. I see it's people have culture here. People have the life like any people around the world, and I just make the first friend in your village, and in the same day the occupation is killing him. And he say, I will never believe what Israeli propaganda, what they say about the Palestinians. But if I am not say this by my eyes, I will never believe, he say. Now he's become activist and he become photojournalist and he publishing many things about Palestine and Palestinians and about occupation. And he's become the photographer from the Active Steel. And I know him from close. And he's still doing his work. But this this man, if he not meet Palestinian, or he if he not see how the soldiers is kill people for nothing, he will never believe. And I asking or I invite people to come here to Palestine and to see the truth and the reality here, to see what, how the occupation is treat the Palestinians, and how the occupation is not give any chance for Palestinians to live in peace here. If you traveling around West Bank, you will see 60% from West Bank now is settlement, and a lot of checkpoint everywhere. If you thinking about peace negotiation, you can find nothing.
And what about the water? What about the water in your regions near the West Bank?
Water is another big story. Palestinians, it's buy their water from Israel now. For example, we have a village called Chibtin here. We have they have a big water well. It's the British making during the British occupation in Palestine, and they're making this well in village called Chibtin, for example. Israelis occupied this well and take the water to the settlement. All the settlements around, and they give the water back for Palestinians, sell them their water, and expensive double more than the settlers. If you want to come and to see how every settlement, to visit every settlement, they have a lot of swimming pools, they're using water everywhere, they have very big gardens. And but if you visit the side of Palestine, you will see no swimming pools. Not everywhere you have green gardens because the water is expensive. What we have tanks on every home roof to save the water and for the home, you're using for home, but for the farmers, it's we're using little bit, and we're using the rain water. We collect the rain water, we're making like small wells, wells, and we collect the water from the roofs, and we take to the wells, and after we take from the wells and send to the farmers, to the farmer. The Palestinian, for example, the settler, he use seventy liter of the water every day, but the Palestinians he use seven. It's a big different. And at the same time, it's our water, and they take from our land. They occupy it under the land and the sky. They occupy everything. They not let us to have any chance to live with dignity and peace.
Just to illustrate that, for a lot of people, I would recommend some of the photos that you have on your website and page. I've seen a lot of very powerful ones that show the borderland, you know, near between Israel and Palestine, and just the difference in the amount of just excess water available to the people of Israel as opposed to the Palestinians, where it's just like very barren. You know, there's no extra trees and bushes and grass and. You know, it's just a ridiculous contrast, you know, in the same photo, you know, very powerful image.
Yes, our land is, we plant the olive trees. Most of our trees is olive trees because this tree, it's taking the water from the rain, and she not need any water in the summer.
But it takes a long time. It takes a long time for them to grow.
Yeah, exactly.
To produce olive. I know they will burn them. Is that correct?
Yeah, yes. For example, my village have a lot of Roman olive trees. It's very big olive tree, very big trees, and it's very old. But you know, it's the only the tree is empty from inside, and the soldiers during the demonstration was using the tear gas canister with fire. In summer, there was burned a lot of this trees. If you come to my village to visit, I will show you how they burned these trees. And you can see, you can still see a little bit trees there, but not like before. They change all the area. It's like war area.
Well, it's one example of how they, it's just one example, I was going to say, of how they try to impact just the potential for your livelihood and how you sustain yourself. And also, I'm sure, to send an intimidating message. As they try to have their own settlers take over more and more of your land.
Yes, in the same time about the trees, the companies was built a settlement. They stole some of these big trees and plant in the settlement to show the settlement that this settlement is it's old settlement and they have old olive trees. It's so difficult what we see in the small village like Bil’in. It's so hard days, so hard time, and everything is changed. It's all the area they change it. But after 11 years, we succeed. We remove the first wall, the one they built in 2005, the fence wall, electric wall. And we also removed the camera. The big camera was control the village. It was watching the village 24 hours. We removed the camera and we destroyed the fence wall. But in the same time, they built the concrete wall around the settlement. We replaced 1,000 dinum from 2,200 dirham, but some of farmers was happy, some of the farmers was sad because they not replay all the land.
I noticed some of the images you captured show the razor wire as well.
Yeah, I make two books about what I document, photos, photo book, and I was writing next every photo what happened here.
And people can find those through your website, I take it?
My website is not really work now. It's haithmkatib.com, but because the website someone is open for me, but now it's not working because we not have visa credit here to continue being for the website. I don't know any news about this guy now, but I publishing my book. In Facebook, I make some books. The book.
Right now, currently, your website is still up where I'm located. I'm still getting it coming up on my computer.
Yes, but I don't know if the guy is still control the website or not. On the website, you can see the name of the book, Through My Lens and Children of Bil’in. You can click there and you can go to another website. The another website is still working. If you want to order, for example, the book. Also, I make two books. It's I never thinking that one day I will be something. I just I was taking or document what happened in my village. Just it's I feel, but because it's really it's my duty to do this because it's my village. But step by step, I see myself like I know how to filming, to editing, to do many things. Also I what is in English, it's like was photo champion. Like I take two prize from Italy. For two pictures, I was succeed in 2014. I winning two prize. It's make me so proud.
Yes, that, congratulations for that.
Yeah, thank you so much. I am proud, and also I am not was planning to have this. But it's step by step, it's happened. I am planning now to make a documentary with the director, the Israeli director, Guy Davidi, who's who's make the five broken cameras. I hope it will be succeed.
Okay.
I'm thinking all the time how to help my people, how to document their suffering and to show other people. And really, I'm so happy because I have this chance to speak and to make my voice aloud and to let other people to hear me.
Hey, can I interrupt for a minute?
Sure.
All right. Sure. Hey, guys. Pardon me. I just want to talk to the listeners real quick because I'm not sure if they understand, but, and I'm going to do my best to always get your name right. Haitham, right? Haitham? Is that close enough?
Haitham.
All right. God, it should be too easy, and I'm making it hard. Haitham. Okay. Haitham. Okay. I'm sorry.
That's English.
I'll get it. I will. I promise. I just want to tell the people that are listening that he is going to be doing a show now starting next week, 2 hours before this time. Starting before Richard's show, starting next week, the show is going to be called Live from Palestine. And as far as I know, we will be the only people in the United States that will be broadcasting a show live from Palestine. I think everybody knows how dangerous this is. Definitely. And how risky, all the risks involved. But I just want him to understand that, and the listeners also, that we will obviously put everything out there, and this is going to be an excellent opportunity to give extra voice where there was no voice before. So it should be very interesting to see what happens as soon as they find out.
I agree. I'm very excited as well.
But yeah, I just want you to know that you're very strong, and it's great because people associated with this group have to be very strong. So we're honored to have you with us. And I just want people to realize just what a big deal it is to be able to produce a radio show live from Palestine with a person of his journalist credentials. So as people get to learn more about who this person is, they'll begin to realize just how lucky we are to be able to be involved in giving him an extra voice for Palestine.
Certainly.
And that's so really much. All I want
I
to say right
I
now.
I am the one lucky.
Well, we're all working in the same fight, right? This is all the same fight. We're the same team. So we're going to do everything we can to help, just the same way as we try to help people in Syria or Donbass or any place like that, you know. Yes, you know what I'm saying. Yeah,
because the world has become now is business.
Yeah,
it's the war. All the wars is it's about business. Every war, every kind of war is business. It's so hard, and the people have to wake up. The silent is kill us. And please don't be silent.
I want to say is Haitham, are you able to bring guests? Do you have enough people around, English speaking people, that can come and talk and because it's so important. If every week you can bring a new person or some people to talk about other journeys. And even
your time is difficult to collect people in the morning.
Yeah. Well, we can do different.
But I can. Yes. Well, yes. If you have
someone special, anytime you have a special guest, and they have a restriction on time, we will make a show just for that time.
Yes, for sure. It's make me so happy to make a Palestine voice allowed.
Okay. I'm going to let you go. I'm going to go back to listening, but I just that's all I need to say right now. All right? I'm working on your show as we speak.
Okay.
Well, this is pretty exciting, isn't it, Haitham? I mean, you're definitely going to be appreciated, I think, from the listeners that we've been building for the station.
Every time when we speak about Palestine, we feel that it's not enough for Palestine. I speak about my village, but I'm not speaking about every place in Palestine, and every place have his suffering. Everyone he have his suffering in Palestine. It's so difficult to explain this. It's just if you live under occupation. Now the world is wake up, and we have the BDS against Israel, the boycott, like what happened in South Africa and was succeed, and we have it now everywhere in the world. It means the people is wake up. And if you ask me what Israel hate now, they hate the internet, because internet is showing the truth, and people start to understand what the occupation plan every time.
Certainly, yeah. I hear they're the biggest ones who want to censor it to their own interests.
We have. We have the free speech, we have the radios, we have websites, Facebook, internet. We can feel little free there to speak about ourselves.
Well, I think more and more people have been waking up to just who has been doing what, responsible for what, and just the kind of values that everyone truly has, no matter what we hear on the surface, because more and more people are going to the alternative, independent, the independent media like yourself for their answers.
Yes, I am proud that I'm a photojournalist or a filmmaker or anything like this, because see, it's very important thing. Every checkpoint in Palestine, Israeli checkpoint, have a lot of cameras, and sometimes they kill people in checkpoint, and they're not showing their cameras. Why? Because they do something wrong. They know they do something wrong, and they're not showing. And all the time they're speaking about it's security thing. We have Beit Salem organization with us. I am volunteer of this organization. The filming, or they have a lot of volunteer in Palestine and filming all the time what Israel soldiers doing in West Bank. Harassment people, how they demolishing homes, how many, many things. And it's help us to It's now in Palestine, for example, they give the green light, a light for soldiers to kill any Palestinians that try to attack soldiers, or any Palestinians try to attack settlers.
So it's and word, just whatever that soldier says goes. You know,
yes. But you have to know that this soldier is 18 years old. It's children with guns, and right. they like this. They
and
kill
they get conditioned.
Many people.
They get conditioned in a very extreme.
Exactly, they kill many people a few months ago, and they still kill people. They killed two guys, one from Shafat, next Jerusalem, and another one. And they're speaking that they killed them by wrong way. Also, next to my village here, they kill one child, 14 years old. He was coming back to his home. He was in swimming pool, and they kill him in the night, and they say it's wrong kill. The settlers run over to the child, 6 years old, yesterday, and it's so easy to kill here. And many times they say they try to stamp soldiers. And a few times the Palestinians camera filming that the soldiers was throw the knife next to the people after they killed him. And you see, maybe you see when one Palestinians get injured and the two Israeli ambulance was next to him, they not help him, and one soldier just come and shoot him in his head from the camera. A lot to think, but if we not have cameras and we not have people stand next to us, and we cannot show you anything from Palestine, and we need little to be brave and to take our cameras and to document what Israel doing here, what the occupation is doing, what we need just to end the occupation. About their propaganda that Muslims hate Jewish, it's not true. We not have any problem with Jewish. I have many, many friends, Jewish friends, and I'm not have any problem with them. And any Palestinians not have any problem with Jewish. We just have one problem, the occupation.
That's the Israeli government and Zionism, basically.
Yes, exactly. We want to end this Zionist occupation. That's it.
I know when we work. Speaking last week, I brought up Hamas and how the Israeli press and the influence they have on the American press tries to depict Hamas as a terrorist group. And of course, I'm aware that that's not at all the case. They were voted by popular vote into a position of representing the interests of the Palestinian people. And what would you say in response to the Israeli press condemning them as terrorists?
Yes, I can hear about terrorist groups like ISIS. ISIS is working outside of his countries, or they're coming from everywhere from the world and terrorize in Syria, in Iraq, and in Libya, and in Egypt. I can say they are terrorist group, ISIS. But I cannot say for any Palestinians movement or group they are terrorists, because they defend themselves and they fighting on their land. They're not going to terrorize anyone in any place in this world. Give me just one time Hamas is making the bad thing outside or in America, for example, or any place in the world. They never do anything outside of Gaza, just Gaza. We know that Hamas is fighting Israel because Israel is making massacres in Gaza. It's so clear. It's I can understand this. They try to defend themselves. They try to defend Gaza. But I cannot understand how this group is terrorist group. No, I cannot understand this. It's not true. It's not true because if listen, something you have to know. Israel is love if we using the violence, because they have reason to kill Palestinian. They love if the Palestinians fighting with guns, because they will using the tanks, and they will invade the cities and destroy everything, and they will say to all the world, see, the Palestinians is attacking Israel, or the Palestinians is terrorism people. Palestinians know this, and it's my village idea was the nonviolent resistance was very good and succeed idea, because these soldiers who have a lot of weapon on his body, he was looking and didn't know what to do from these people, because these people is empty hands and just using their voice to say, stop Israel, don't build the settlement in my land, and stop the occupation. It's a very simple resistance. And it's not new. It's happened in the first intifada. The Palestinians use this resistance in first intifada, and they're using this in the second intifada. I'm not interesting with other violent resistance. I'm interesting with our my village resistance, the nonviolent resistance against occupation, and I am sure it's very succeed way what we doing now. If you look to Bil’in, it was no one know Bil’in before, but now it's the symbol of the nonviolent resistance in Palestine. It's something. And see, look how much people we know now around the world, and it's I see it's succeed way, and I like it.
Yes, I'm very much looking forward to having you added to the station as well. I think it's going to be an excellent opportunity for you know, you to get your voice out to more people, just in the West and throughout. Well, internationally, we've been growing quite a bit of an audience in general, you know, just all of the English speaking listeners that we've been building.
My English is not good.
Oh no! I think it's fine. I think it's fine for, you know. I mean,
yes, but sometimes if you're using heavy words in English, I am not understand this. I speak like street language, like I speak with friends, like easy language. And I learned the English language from friends who's coming to Palestine and enjoy our demonstrations, and we sometimes speak with friends in Facebook and Skype, I learned step by step by the teaching me.
Well, I think that you have done an excellent job of acquainting yourself with it as a second language, because I think you'll do just fine as a show host. But
I speak Hebrew very well.
Did I screw up the sound, you guys, when I came in there?
I heard a little something. I know we didn't take a break, and I apologize, Stephen.
Oh, is it break time? Oh, yeah. I've been listening. I forgot about that. Sorry. I just wanted to say, don't worry about your English, but obviously, Richard, you have to be, I thought maybe he didn't understand you, perhaps. But let's go ahead and take a break since I'm interrupting you anyway, okay?
All right, sounds good.
All right, let's just do that real quick. Okay, anyway, I just want to remind everybody that this is Truth Cat Radio, www.truthcatradio.com. And the guest tonight is going to be starting a new show next week at 2 hours before this time, and it's going to be called Live from Palestine. Tomorrow night at 6 p.m., there is another new show going to be debuting, and it's called Mind Matters. And the host of that is Ahmad Inani. I hope I said his name right. Probably said it wrong. Daryl Nichols returns, and he has a special guest who is a healer. Actually, he does healing on animals, like a Reiki healer, I suppose. And she is going to be on at 8 p.m. Eastern. Madison Starmood comes back. Go ahead and mute your microphone. Listen to him typing away. I'm sorry.
Yeah,
Haitham. Haitham. Yeah, mute your microphone for me, please. Okay, thank you. Sorry, guys. Anyway, again, Madison Starmoon is on at 10 p.m. Eastern, and that's Amanda Danielle. Of course, she has actually three or four very special guests. I don't have their names in front of me. Sorry. Thursday at 6 p.m. Eastern, Graham Sutherland with Delete the Beast. He will be followed by at 8 p.m. Eastern by Jay Parker with Matrix Warrior. Immediately after Jay Parker is going to be the Stephen D. Kelly Show, and that's going to be a very special show. We're having Sophia Stewart return, and we're going to be a new book. Hi, Tam.
Yes.
Mute your microphone. Hit that.
I'm live. I'm still live.
Yeah. You got to hit the microphone right there when we're on break. Kill the sound.
Okay.
Don't hang up. All right. Anyway, Sophia Stewart's going to return, and we are going to be talking about the new book, Matrix 4. And hopefully that'll be coming a movie very soon. Rodrigo is probably going to be returning. I just talked to him today. He's had a pretty serious blood infection, but it's looks like it's pretty much healing up pretty well. I'm not sure if he'll be back in time, but he may very well be by Friday. That would be at 8 p.m. Eastern. And he will be followed at 10 p.m. Eastern by Eric Dadmer and Love Vibrations. Jay Parker, of course, is on at Sunday with The Center Path at 8 p.m. Eastern. I want to remind everybody to try to help us out as much as you can on Facebook by liking the various pages, sharing the pages, becoming members, whatever it takes, joining groups, and sharing our advertisements to groups. And please, if you can, join the chat page and go in there and register a screen name in the chat page and get active in there and say hello to everybody and ask us questions. And also, of course, if you would like to call in, and this is a great opportunity for you to ask questions, the phone number is 714-598-3125. That's in the USA, of course. If you're outside the USA, you've got to use the country code for the United States, which I believe is 001. And it's going to cost you money. If you'd like to save money, you can call and use Skype, but you'll have to connect to me, Stephen D. Kelly, and I will have to accept you, and you will have to let me know that you would like to come on the radio when you message me. Beyond that, I want to remind also, of course, that we are 100% listener supported. So please, we will accept any donations from anybody. Go to our page, and there is a button that says "Support Us" on the www.truthcat page, and that's how you. There's the instructions there for how you can send us funds to help us continue running and help us grow. And Haitham, you might be interested. Christ, I'm going to keep screwing up your name. We're going to probably be doing TV too eventually, so that would be awesome to be able to broadcast a video from Palestine. Sound good? Yeah. Oh, he's muted. I should leave him alone. All right, everybody. I suppose that is it. But again, this is Truth Cat Radio, www.truthcatradio.com. This is Beyond the Matrix with Richard Kary, and the guest today is Haitham Khatib. Excuse me for that. Anyway, again, I will return, and welcome back, everybody. Take it away. Richard, where are you?
I'm here. Hello. Haitham, are you still with us?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, I think Stephen and I are both still struggling with your pronunciation of your name, but Haitham.
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 Al-Khatib. It's not difficult. It's English.
There's like an A sound at the start of your last name, then. Like Al-Khatib. All right, the KH is a little bit silent. Al-Khatib.
I take the L out to make my name easy. Haitham Khatib.
I see.
Yeah.
All right, Haitham. Well, I'm trying to think of where we left off. I know we were speaking about Hamas. I don't know how many of our listeners out there are aware, but perhaps they are if they use a lot of the same Facebook resources we do, like the Truth Cats group. I believe I added you to that Truth Cats group, by the way. But as far as the impression of Israel that most people in your area, you know, of your village or like near Jerusalem, I mean, surely it's not, even though the media, perhaps there's not too much that you have for your options. What sort of impression from the locals, I mean, is there of the Israeli government? I mean, surely they cannot think that they have the best interests of the people. I mean, they are claiming others are terrorists when surely, from what I can see, most people in Palestine would have to believe the Israelis are more the terrorists locally, just like they are in other parts of the world, behind a lot of its end.
You see, I tell you before that Cubation is fighting to save the Cubation, and he can call anyone terrorist. Anyone in Palestine, he can call terrorist, but it's occupation. It's
genocide. It seems like there's a slow genocide going on.
Yes, exactly. But the people not have to believe them.
They would like Palestine to eventually just get wiped out through gradual, slow measures over a few decades, few more decades or something. And that's what I think they want to see.
Yes, and especially American people. We have a lot of friends of American people. We like them. We meet them here in Palestine. They see everything. Many things happened here in Palestine. And everyone, he say, I will not pay any. I am not going to pay more money for to support Israel. Because I see what Israel doing. I meet a Jewish journalist. She's a young girl. She's come to my village. And I was speak with her about what happened. And she was writing all the time. But I never know she's a journalist. But she was interesting what I was speaking about, and especially water, land, trees, and this stuff. And I speak about that Israel killed my friend here in my village, and he do nothing. And she saw also the video when the Israel soldiers killed him. You know what she say? She say, Haitham, I am so sorry I am Jewish. I tell her, what the problem? You are Jewish. She said, because it's my people. It's they are Jewish people is occupied you and make this this suffering for you. I tell her, you have to know that the Zionist is making this, not the Jewish. The really Jewish who's really it's like
Orthodox Jew.
Yeah, it's okay. We have Orthodox Jewish. We have a lot of kinds of Jewish, but we speaking about the Zionist. I tell you, we're exactly. Not speaking about your religion.
Yeah,
don't believe what they say about Islam and Jewish and Muslims what want to kill Jewish and this lies. It's all lies.
You know, one thing that I have noticed, Haitham, is that in this part of the world, the West, I think there's more of a a murky merging of the two. Unfortunately, in your part of the world, it seems like there's a clear distinction between the people who disagree with the Zionists and the Israeli government, and the people who, the people who side with them, and the people who of course do not, who are Jewish. But over, I think a lot of people are persuaded. In the States, the United States and Canada and in Europe, to just support each other, just simply because they are Jewish, and they don't look too deeply behind it any more than that. So I think there is more of a problem where, at least in the Middle East, I think that it does seem more common where people distinctly see the differences and do not make that mistake, really.
Yes, see. Before a few years, I lost a son. He has a cancer, and I look for the best hospitals. I see that in Israel have the good hospitals for this disease. Okay, we send him there, and they give me permission in the beginning. And they stopped to give me permission after, till he died. In the hospital, I understand English and Hebrew. I was see that groups coming and visit the hospital, coming from America, and there was donate money for the hospital. I was thinking, My child is that the Palestinian Authority is cover him the money and a lot of money they pay for this hospital, and why this support coming? It's like business hospital, or all the Israel hospitals is business hospital. They take a lot of money from who's going to take the treatment. And one day they tell my wife, if you not have the cover money in the hospital, we are sorry, you have to go home. And it was so hard because the senior security is not have the good time to give you every time what the hospital ask you. And it's I understand that many of people is supporting Israel, but they didn't know anything. Many of people is supporting from their money, supporting groups here in Israel. They build settlement in Palestinian land. It's like they support them to stall other people land and to build settlements and it's I wanted to say to tell these people, I want to say that please stop to support occupation against us, and please see the truth and follow the truth, what happened here in Palestine. And it's so easy if you want to know the truth. It's so easy you can get it. It's not so difficult. And so it's my message for people to wake up a little bit.
Yeah, well, I think it varies for everyone. Some people need to have firsthand experiences to really change, you know.
Yeah, yes, we want them to change. And be sure, Palestinians just need to live in peace. See, they want to live in peace and dignity. If you come to Palestine and you see how the people live under the occupation, it's really like a miracle. It's long years we have the same occupation. We faces the soldiers every day. We faces the settlement every day. We faces everything. Everything make us lost the hope every day. 25 years we waiting the peace. And what we have in this 25 years, a lot of settlement, 3 wars against Gaza, or 3 massacres. We have in Jerusalem attacking the prayer in Jerusalem, the people going to pray. One girl or few girls, the soldiers shoot them in the checkpoint because soldiers want to speak with them and they not understand Hebrew. It's like, for example, always they asking for a woman have a hijab to take the hijab off to see, like it's to see that she's not hold anything with in her body, and she's not understand what the soldiers asking her. They're shooting her. It's not her fault because she's not no Hebrew, and in the end they banned Muhammad Ikhdir, the child in Jerusalem. They kidnap him. The settlers kidnap him and burned him alive. And also they attacking family in Douma, next Nablus, and they burned family alive. Dawabsha family, if you hear about Dawabsha family, just one child survived. And how Palestinians can be silent and waiting for nothing? It's long years now, long years we asking for peace, but we not see the peace. We not see the serious people making peace with us.
Yes, when you say long years, I mean, that really is the case. You spoke of your grandfather earlier, and when you think of just how much land has been continually taken from Palestine, and so many people... They're starting to remove this from history books, trying to, tell people lies about the past.
Yes, every day we lost lands. Every day we see, for example, West Bank is going to be smaller than before. It's occupation, and it's his way to occupy it. It's incubation, nothing nice in incubation. It's very bad thing what we have.
Well, I don't know if there are any particular situations that you'd like to talk about, you know, experiences that you've had in your past. You mentioned that one photographer or videographer, a friend of yours. an experience. He had a traumatic moment of just the things he witnessed that made him suddenly decide to take up journalism and to try to do something. He realized finally how bad things really were. You know, I wonder just how many people who aren't naturally led to want to know the truth, you know, will be able to be made aware of this. You know,
in very easy, like we can say, Palestinians live under Israel apartheid conditions. Every journalist know what happened here. Every media. But we need people help us to make our voice aloud, to tell everyone what happened here. I have many friends, journalist friends, but we need other people to have contact with them, to have contact, to speak with them, to hear what they see every day. The normal people, they can see for example the video on the internet one time or two times, but we as a journalist, we see the video 100 times. It's in our computer, and we editing. We always see the footage. We feel a double feeling what anyone feel. It's we cannot keep this inside of us. We have to tell this to tell everyone.
Yes, I know that they had another increase during 2016 in the attacks. 2014 had quite severe attacks on Gaza, and we had just such a censorship in the West, you know, in the corporate media, and people. There were reports of a lot of threats to people who had prestigious positions, you know, people in Hollywood and that sort of thing, just threatened to not speak about Gaza, of course. And now I know this year we've had another increase in attacks in the Gaza region. And of course, yeah, you mentioned that a lot of this on a smaller scale happens in all the other regions, the West Bank and in your areas close to the villages around Jerusalem as well. A lot of the stories and accounts you have, I know, span all of those regions. You and a few other contributors for the videos and the photography on your website and page.
Yeah. Israel wants the world to believe Palestinians are terrorists, but we are not. We are just resisting their illegal occupation. Palestinians want peace. We love our land and we want to live normally, like everyone. That's it. Palestinians want human and equal rights.
I mean, we just need to spread these messages, these things that you're saying, you know, just breaking it down for people and reminding them and let them share that information with others so that we can overcome the corporate media's lies. It basically twists everything around. I mean, it's interesting how Israel has had such a close relationship with trade and dealing with arms to South Africa, for example, when they've had horrible apartheid in their past, and here, you know, of course, in their own homeland, you know, Israel does the same thing with the Palestinians. It's really horrible, but it's also a slow genocide, like we say. You know, it's not just apartheid. It's gradually taking up all of the land of Palestine and killing off any people who are trying to remain and not immigrate elsewhere is really the end goal, I would have to say.
Yeah. Yes, for sure. Of course, the media is lie. the lies all the time, and especially the Israel media, because it's a media of occupation. Israel occupation, it's save the occupation. They have to save the occupation because it's their way. They didn't want Palestinians to live in peace or to have country, for example. They're speaking about two country solution, but I can't see Israel. They already make their country in our land, but they're not give us any hope to build our country in West Bank and Gaza, because most of West Bank now, it's, if you look to the Palestinians map, you can understand this. 60% from West Bank settlement, Gaza in siege. Between Gaza and West Bank, it's so difficult to have contact. If you want to contact Gaza, now you can go to Egypt, then to Jordan, then to West Bank. It's so difficult. They not give us chance to make our country. It means they not want us to make our country. They're just lying to people. They're just lying. In Oslo peace negotiation, they give the authority to come to control some cities here in West Bank. And in the second intifada, they destroyed all. Now they bring them, they give them again to control the cities, but they not give the security in the cities. They not give them or let them to control the other villages around the cities. It's mean it's not no future for country here in Palestine, and we need solution now. We need solution. It's so difficult. They not give any solution, any chance or nothing. Nothing. Imagine 8 million Palestinians refugees outside. We have here just in Palestine, it's about 4 or 5 million. 1 million and 600 or 400 in Gaza, and 1,300,000 in Israel. They have Israeli citizens. They are Palestinians they are Palestinians when the Israel occupied in 48, and then we have the West Bank. It's about 3 million people, but. It's so difficult to have the chance to make country here, but we have a hope, we still have a hope to live like other people, to have freedom. Yes. Israel is dividing our village and continues. It's so hard. It's between the village and the other village. You have checkpoints sometimes. In Second Intifada, most of West Bank was checkpoints. You cannot go to any place. In the same time, I remember my father was sick. He has a cancer, and there was checkpoint between my village and the Ramallah city. And it was difficult to send my father to the hospital. It was so hard. Now they take the checkpoints out, and they keep some in West Bank, but they're still harassing people. So difficult. I invite you to visit Palestine, and you will see by your blue eyes everything.
Certainly.
Yes.
I think maybe if enough of the world, you know, the rest, if enough people can become aware of what's really happening, the scale that it's happening on, and just what these different groups' motives really are, just to understand Zionism and just to distinguish it and what its force really is, it, just to get enough people to not buy the cover story, if you will, you know, that Israel presents itself as to the world, you know, and the way it gets away with so much. I know more people are changing their mind. The former prime minister of I believe it's the Netherlands, former prime minister, he was just quoted in saying that the era where Israel is able to just get accepted to the world without question is over. You know, I mean, it's time for it to be accountable, just like any other country or a nation state. And I know there was one member of the Netherlands parliament who wouldn't shake Benjamin Netanyahu's hand at a recent meeting that made a lot of the news. But examples of how more of the world is starting to change, you know, and to look at what things really are about, you know, and how humane.
I hope that Benjamin Netanyahu he understand the message when this guy not check his hand. I hope he's will understand that he's not welcome there, but I don't know. It's a lot of people is making demonstration also against the Netanyahu visit in Netherlands. It's so clear now the world is start to wake up. It's we have everyday friends stand next to us. It's every day it's growing. They are growing.
And this is not a moment too late, you know. I mean, it's a shame. We could not have it happen sooner with all the land that has already been taken. But, you know, who knows what we can do for the future, you know, for Palestine. It would be good if we could restore as much as possible of what they've been.
Yeah. I see the demonstration in Netherlands that they called him the children killer. It's what he's doing in against Gaza.
Okay.
It's the one woman, she say, I'm now 80 years old, and I still see the Israeli occupation on Palestine. And a lot of people, they speak like boycott Israel, about boycott Israel, and they are resist against occupation outside. A lot of people, they're reading Palestine history, and they visit Palestine, and they see everything from close. It's... See, if you not say the truth, it's mean you are not alive. And well, yes. Everyone, he have to say the truth.
Well, yes, I've heard the same thing. The boycott, divestment, and sanctions has been having a lot of progress, and Israel has not been able to stop the amount of progress that it has made.
Yeah, exactly. It's I visit some countries like Italy, Switzerland, Belgium, France, and I see the people there, and I see what they're doing. It's most of people I visit there, they're not buying the stuff of Israel. Before they're buying something, they're looking to the number. I respect that. I feel that I am... with my family there, I feel that this people is trying to help us, to give us our freedom. I feel, but they say we not just want to help you. We have to be like, or to feel that we are human living this world. We not have to be silent. And the truth, the silence is kill us. Really, it's the truth. If the world, if this world still silent, it's all the Palestinians will die, or will Israel will kick them from their land, or kill them, or keep them in jails. And we need your voice. We need you to be next to us all the time.
Yeah, so you're confirming that if things continue going as they have been, that eventually all of Palestine will become extinct.
Yeah.
Basically,
yes.
They're all their land yes. taken, all the people gone.
Yes, Israel is very scared of the BDS because it was successful in South Africa. We hope that it will help Palestinians too.
For people who don't, I don't know if there's anyone out there who doesn't understand the entire history, but I mean, all of that is Israel used to be part of Palestine. I mean, it's just been a small amount that was really in the center of it initially. Isn't that correct? It wasn't really near the borders of any of the other nations. It was all completely isolated, like an island inside Palestine originally? Or am I incorrect on that?
Maybe I'm not understand the question.
Oh, I just mean on the map, you know, the borders the original Israel borders from 1948. I'm just talking about, yeah.
It's like a joke.
Yeah.
Was no Israel before 48?
No. I mean the original amount of land they took in 1948. I mean, as compared to today, the amount that they have increased since then.
Every Palestinian's refugees, he know where he was live.
That too, though, they are trying to remove that from the history books. They want people to think the other way around, that Palestine never existed and it was just a small movement of people for a short amount of time. and then Israel has always, you know, had claims to this. They just weren't doing much for a while in the region is all. But we're back. Yes. You should be reminding everyone out there of that. Prior to 1948, that Israel did not exist whatsoever. And the young people out there, anyone listening who isn't fully aware of this, please confirm the history a bit for the listeners, if you wouldn't mind.
Yeah. Yeah, it's maybe Israel was thinking like this. If the old people die, the young people, they will not remember. But it's not true. I see the children, the very small children, is want to visit Yaffa or any city inside of Israel. It's they know that there was a Palestine one day. And we have a lot of documents that how Palestine looked before. Jewish was live with us also, but not the Zionist. Jewish, Christian, Muslims was live like a family here in Palestine. But when the Zionist coming, it's happened what happened. This what. What I try to say that we not have problem with Jewish, because already Jewish was live with us. They was little, but they was live with us. A lot of document we have. We have Palestinian money also before 48. We have a document of. For example, IDs, Palestinians' IDs, document, and we have a lot of papers. Was before Israel government. Also, I forget her name. She was by minister, Israel by minister. Yeah, Golda Meir, yes. She's take visa from Palestine country to go to travel outside. It was no Israel. In the same time, she was Jewish, and she take visa from Palestine country to go to visit outside. And a lot of old document still you that they are lies and they try to change the history. If you come to my village, for example, or to any village in Palestine, and you go to the old village, you will see the building, very, very old building. What this mean? It mean we was live here before Israel coming.
Well, they want to hide that, it seems.
They want to hide, yes, yeah, yes.
A lot of the ancient proof from the archaeological remains in the on the land, you know, the evidence of so how long the civilizations have been there, both in Palestine and in neighboring countries. Yeah, they want the same. They would like the same erased from Iran, Syria. You know, they can't help but be jealous of these cultures that have lasted long before the Israelites. And of course, their claim to that land is very slight when they've actually come from the Khazarian region throughout their migrations.
See what the big problem that every Israeli leader in the end, everyone in the end, he will say, we have to make solution between us and Palestine, and the Palestinians have to be to have a country. The last one was Ariel Sharon, and the one he was really really very bad leader of Israel was against Palestinians, Ariel Sharon, and in the end he say Palestinians have to have. To have the country and to make peace. It's just in the end they say this. Why they not say this when they control or when they are leaders? But when they finish to be leaders, they say the truth. It's because also the occupation is not believe occupation. They know that it's wrong to occupy other people and to make them suffering. It's wrong. But I, like what I tell you, it's every war. It's who's making, it's just the businessman's. It's all the wars is business. It's about business.
Yes.
And Israel occupation, it's all about business.
Well, thank you very much for being with us today, Haitham. And I'm looking forward to
the time now.
I can't believe actually how fast 2 hours went by there. Actually, it was
5 o'clock in the morning. I'm full of sleep, and I'm so sorry. But if we can making this before like morning,
hey guys. Yes. Just want to let you know it's about that time, and I'm going to take over because, believe it or not, Press TV contacted me. They want me to talk about Israel shelling the Golan Heights.
Excellent.
So, yeah, but they want to do that right at the top of the hour, so I'm going to go ahead and let you guys finish it up right now. And, Haitham, I'm going to have everything done with your show and publicized tonight, and very excited about it. I noticed looking at your webpage that you're connected to a few of my friends, and I see that you're connected to Press TV and a few of the producers over there. So this sounds like a very, very wonderful opportunity.
You're most welcome, and I was so happy to be in your radio show.
And, I'm looking forward to keeping in touch. If you're going to be on right before me,
yes,
I have to call into your show. Okay, at the end of your show.
Well, let's go ahead and finish it up, guys.
All right. Well, thank you very much for being here. We'll post your websites and everything up with the link to the video so that you can share that with everyone, and we'll share it as well.
I am more active on Facebook. You can publish my Facebook page or my personal Facebook, Haitham Khatib.
What we'll do is we'll create a Facebook page for your show, and when we start advertising on the main Truthcat Radio page, all of your ads will go from there, and they will be posted to all of your various pages. So we'll hope that you'll help us share. And, of course, there's a lot of groups involved in helping Palestine and anti-Zionism and this sort of thing. So I think you could become very, very popular.
Thank you so much for this chance to help my Palestinian people. Really, great. Thank you so much.
All right. Richard, go ahead and say good night.
And
we'll talk to you very soon.
Okay, thank you so much.